Hello and welcome to The Big Picture. An Intelligence Bureau report prepared for the PMO, which has found its way to the media, has caused a major controversy. The report, which goes into the working of several NGOs, has charged many of them which works in the areas of nuclear issues, human rights, genetically modified technology, livelihood issues, and so on, as being a threat to national economic security. The report has named many such NGOs and their foreign funding sources, and how these foreign funds are being used to destabilize projects, influence and shape policy debates, and so on. The activists and NGOs who have been the target in this report have reacted sharply and expressed concerns about this report being a precursor to an anti-democratic and repressive crackdown on dissent and human and democratic rights of the people. It's also being seen as a way of supporting the corporate-led economic agenda. What does this report mean and how serious is the problem? Is the charge of foreign agencies and countries infiltrating through these NGOs and influencing policy decisions and debate valid? What would be the impact on democratic rights to dissent and protest if this report is acted upon? We will discuss all this today with DC Pathak, former Director, Intelligence Bureau, Anil Chaudhary, Coordinator, Indian National Social Action Forum, or INSAF, Saikat, Datta, Editor, National Security, Hindustan Times, and Suman, Sahai, Chairperson of the Gene Campaign, on phone line from Uttarakhand. Welcome to all of you. Mr. Pathak, is this kind of report a routine thing which the IB does to the government, or is this a special report? Because we are told that it has been given to the PMO, and Home Minister has said that I don't know anything about this report.
Are you referring to why it has appeared in the media?
No, I'm not saying why it has appeared. Okay. It has appeared. I mean, there's been no denial that the report has been done.
Let me make three short points to put the discussion on course. One, our intelligence agencies have a unique advantage of having been allowed to come to a judgment about a prospective threat to national security and have the freedom of starting to cover it without having to take anybody's permission about them, right?
In the normal course.
No, this is how we have worked after
independence. That's what you're supposed to do.
If you're referring to somebody who did something at behest of somebody, I'm talking of the institutional integrity with which our intelligence agencies work. Number two, about this so-called NGOs. You know, even in the days of Cold War, the two sides floated forums and advocacy groups to either promote communism or to oppose it, right? So there's nothing extraordinary about the phenomenon that kind of such forums in public may have been floated whose credentials are less than honest, right? Number three, when the intelligence agency puts out something to the government, they won't release a report unless they are convinced that they are very solid grounds. They are on solid ground. They'll rather withhold a report than run into charge of inadequately processed report. And this is the kind of report which must have been worked through over months. Right?
Right.
So this question of timing, any time is good enough for such
we're
a report.
We're not talking
to
of
be
timing
made
at all.
So these are the three basics which we can organize.
You're saying that these kind of reports are a routine thing which the IB does to the government.
Why do you use the word routine? Do you know that this is a subtle form of subversion, influencing individuals and influencing people?
You are coming
people
to a judgment. I'm not asking. I'm asking you a very simple, straight question. Is the IB routinely, does the IB routinely do these kind of reports about NGOs, about organizations which are functioning in this country?
This is a major part of the IB's plate.
It is the major part of the plate.
You see, to screen out organizations which there may be grounds for suspecting they are indulging in soft or hard version of subversion.
The report says that this is a threat. All these agencies are a threat to national economic security. Saikat, this report has not been denied so far. It's been 2 days old. Nobody has denied it from the government, except Home Minister reportedly saying that I don't know anything about it. But there is no denial from the PMO. So the report is a, you know, exists.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So how do you look at this report? Is this something which, as Mr. Pathak is saying, that this is something which the IB is supposed to do always? Or do you see this report as something special which has been done specifically for this government at its request?
No, let's look at what Mr. Pathak has said, and he's made some very interesting points. A, yes, it is correct that it is the IB's charter to look at any threat to national security, whether economic, political or any other, and that is an essential function that it needs to do. Having said that, let's also look at the other aspect of what Mr. Pathak said, that the organization is well within its powers to take a judgment call on what is a threat. Now, here it becomes a little problematic for me, because if we are to look at it from that perspective, that, you know, we always have this old saying that who is watching the watchers?
Right.
So if an organization is making these value judgments, and here is an organization that works in secrecy, there is not really any parliamentary oversight, politicians, media, etc., has very little scrutiny on them. So whatever it does will be between the government and the agency. And it will constantly remain secret. In a situation right. like that, you could say just about anything and therefore brand certain movements or certain people in such a manner which can become very, very problematic. For example, I'll give you one quick example. You say that environmentalists are in some ways, because of certain kinds of funding, etc., are influencing or blocking progress. But the Constitution of India under Article 51A, if I'm not wrong, says that every Indian and every citizen must do everything possible to protect the environment.
Right.
So if these kind of contradictions are not addressed, then where do we go?
You said something about value judgment. Well, I'll just mention Mr. Pathak, this part of the report, and as you know, it's not been denied so far. The negative impact, the report says, the negative impact on GDP growth is assessed to be 2-3% per annum. Now, how does the IB, people in the IB, whoever has prepared the report, how do they come to this kind of a conclusion? Are they economists? What kind of background do people who are preparing this report have? You know, these are questions which are obviously going to come up. But Mr. Pathak, I'm not going to ask you to reply to this. If you want to reply, you can.
No, just a point of, I think this clarification is needed. You know, it's Warren Christopher, Bill Clinton's secretary, famously said in 93, when the Cold War had ended, that national security is inseparable from economic security, which has become a dictum.
Absolutely.
So why are we talking of activities on the economic front? Its connectivity with national security
should
be understood,
and,
right?
Okay, I mean, but the question remains that how capable are these people of? Anyway, Anil Chaudhary,
yes,
you people, INSAF has also been named in this, and you know, you also been come under a cloud. How do you react to this? The report of the IB on you people?
Look, going by my own experience of dealing with the Home Ministry and the FCRA, which is a department within Home Ministry, for last more than 30
years. FCRA is Foreign Contributions
Foreign Contribution English Regulation
Act, which comes under the Home Ministry.
Home Ministry, and it's a department of the whole ministry. And because of the foreign fund issue, we are covered under this
FCRA
department. And going by past experience, I can say that these IB's status report and filing this is a routine matter. Even when we apply for registration, first the police inquiry takes place. IB report is first report filed.
You're supposed to be cleared by the IB
before we get registration.
Right.
And after we get registration, off and on, from local intelligence at the base level till the intelligence branch, it is their regular job to keep track what all we are doing and what all we are not doing. So, in that sense, it is not as a surprise. This report comes to us as a surprise because the way it has come out, about which neither we know anything about, nor other people know. So, it comes to our knowledge through media when it is printed and published.
But so, Mr. Chaudhary, the fact is that INSAF, your organization, had some problems with the government last year. Your fundings were squeezed and your bank, your FCRA registration was cancelled or suspended. So in what context did that happen? And and because these are the things which are being raised in the report also, that why your organization, because there are things about other organizations also dealing with nuclear campaign and things like that. What happened with your organization?
Look, it's very good that you have raised the specific thing, so it makes my job easier to answer the specifics. We received our suspension order on 2nd of May 2013,
right,
which was dated 30th April 2013.
Right.
And that order said that under this clause, your thing is suspended, etc. Now, to best of our understanding of the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act 2010 and related rules, which say very clearly that for any action like this, reasons must be recorded in writing.
Right.
Now, when I see this report, I got this report yesterday only through Indian Express. And here is the, says that point 38, from 2009 to 2012, INSAF's foreign funds were also used to pay at least 15 non-FCRA and these many
26 FCRA organizations.
Now you know our account was suspended. No reason was assigned. So we went to the court, and court has restored our
registration and account.
License. The government order was annulled.
No, but my question.
No, let me yes. complete. So this I am taking as an example. If this fact was known to Home Ministry and the FCRA, they should have suspended our organization citing these reasons, and then we wouldn't have got relief. For me, it is a very simple point. We go and make an application for registration. We are not stupid people. We know that we are committing ourselves to work within this limit,
right,
and we have to comply with the rules and the act. Like I run an organization which has FCRA for last 20 years from 95 onwards.
You have been receiving a regular source, foreign donations from several sources.
Every year we file the return, in which on the left side all the donors and the amount is mentioned. On the right side column, we have to report.
The charge against you against INSAF was, if the reports are right, that you were transferring funds. You were a FCRA organization. You were transferring funds to non-FCRA organizations.
If it is,
and that is something illegal or not? It's not permitted.
Sir, I am saying it is not permitted. If it is true, I shouldn't have been sitting here. The FCRA of INSAF should have been cancelled by now.
Okay, so you are saying that what the so charges were not
surprised
true.
I am surprised.
You are surprised the charges were not true. Anyway, let me get Suman Sahai. Suman Sahai is also, her organization Gene Campaign is also on the radar now. Suman, you heard about what is the report which has come. How do you react to it? You also receive foreign funding, and the charges are that, you know, people like you who receive foreign funding are, you know, shaping policy debates in this country at the behest or in favor of some Western nations.
Girish, I am right now in Uttarakhand, and we have got much more serious problems on our hand. We are trying to work with the farmers to better prepare them for the delayed monsoon, to try and build a little bit more resilience into the agriculture systems, which are in any case marginal. So if really, if we are talking about what will impact GDP, it is lack of paying attention to such issues that will impact the GDP. I'm a little bit amused at the inclusion of genetically modified organisms as a threat to economic security.
Right.
And I'm also wanting to question what is the competence within the IB to be able to make a judgment on the kind of technologies that are concerned with genetic modification.
Right.
And how these value judgments have been arrived at.
Okay.
As far as Gene Campaign is concerned, we have been working with the government on trying to get a better regulatory system. How this is going to improve economic security.
If I'm right, you're on several government formed committees also on these issues.
Yes, I'm on the expert committee of several things advising the government of how to make a better regulation.
Right.
And our contribution has been taken on board in government policy.
Right.
So I must say that I'm both amused and astonished that the IB is wasting the taxpayers' money on tracking things for which it may not have the competence and which is, God knows, non-transparent.
Absolutely.
There is a serious question here about whose economic security is being threatened if GM crops are adopted or not adopted, whether there is a better regulatory system in place or a bad regulatory system in place. These are questions that mystify me as being considered a threat to economic security. I would imagine we want better technology adoption. We want cleaner technology adoption. And people who are asking, incidentally, we are far more supported by government grants than we are by the tiny little grants that we get from development agencies. So this is a complete distortion of the situation.
Okay.
But my question is,
yes,
how is this asking for better systems? How is asking for transparency going to threaten economic security? It's only going to support it.
Absolutely. Okay. Just stay on. I'll come back to you. Mr. Pathak, these are serious questions which are being raised by people like Suman Sahai. She gets government front. She's on government committees. Her opinions are taken by the government bodies and policies are formulated and her opinions are part of it. And now, you know, people like her or people like, even Anil Chaudhary or many other organizations come under a shadow. How do you explain that?
You see, I'm not in a position to comment on the finding of IB on individual organization. I should not, and I'm not in a position to do.
Absolutely.
There are thousands of public-spirited forums working in India for good causes. And perhaps one thing common about their leadership, that they look very frugal. They collect whatever money they can from here or abroad, and they are devoted to a cause. Now, this does not mean that IB should not have the right to see whether there is some area of suspicion, the basis of which is well founded. I'll tell you, if I were I would like to presume that there must be some very extraordinary interpolation of funding against the normal pattern. There must be issue of lifestyle of the leaders who have taken upon themselves this thing. And there must be this examination of whether their activities are in line with the focus declaration and what is happening on the ground. So I'm broadly saying this.
You are giving us a hint about how the IB would have prepared this report. Let me just read two lines from this report. It says the above NGOs, it has named a few NGOs in the above, including INSAF in that. And it says the above NGOs were active facilitators of news articles, liaison with other activists and social media activism, which contributed to the 4-year-old moratorium on BT Brinjal and the ban regimes recommended by Parliamentary Standing Committee in August 2012 and Technical Expert Committee appointed by the Supreme Court in October 2012. You know, the implication, Saikat, if I am right, is that even the Standing Committee of the Parliament and the Technical Evaluation Committee appointed by the Supreme Court are being influenced by these people and are working according to them.
Let me answer this with this example. A lot of credible scientific data in well-respected international scientific magazines has now come out, which show, for example, there was one particular crop which was created to resist a certain kind of parasite. Now that modified, the GM modified crop is no longer safe from that parasite because that parasite has now adapted to the gene mutation that was done to that crop. So this has started raising huge questions about how successful gene mutation really is. Now, this is a scientific finding. And yet, while this scientific finding has been in the public realm for over a year, a report which is done now still reflects that a much earlier position before the scientific finding was founded, that this thing is happening. So my basic point is this, that if you are looking at just about NGOs and giving so much credit to NGOs that they are able to manipulate policy, etc., what happens to those people who actually have the big bucks? For example, there are a huge number of corporate lobbyists who really have the big money.
I'll come to the corporate issue. The other major issue in this report is about the nuclear energy plan, the kind of protests which have been going on and things like that. It talks of anti-nuclear activism in which INSAF is also involved. Were at the forefront of protests against building of nuclear energy plants in India and accused them of coordinating radiation leak studies and instigating protests to stall construction of work. And Mr. Pathak, my question is, are these protests, demonstrations, dissent, anti-national economic security?
Sir, whatever you have read from the report, it does not refer to demonstrations and this. Gene campaign also had the same address. They have referred that six are
yes, in the same building and all that.
So the act by which we are governed, in Rule 3, it covers the actions like demonstration, Rasta Roko, etc., As not allowed. But this holding seminars and preparing reports and liaising with newspaper, it is not cited as not allowed in this.
Yes, Mr.
You see, the overt activity on the ground to discuss that whether it was legal or illegal is getting into peripheral side of it. The main national objective is whether an activity is voluntary or dictated. I won't say anything more than that. So these are the kind of
actions. How do you come to a conclusion whether it is voluntary or dictatorial?
I mean, we are such a major country, with a powerful government. It won't allow any wrong to be gone through. The point is that if an area of suspicion has been raised, it does not mean that straight away you put everybody behind or something. I mean, there will be a way when follow-up action can proceed and should proceed. I mean, it's not about an individual set of people or individual this thing or a particular cause. It's a question of whether there's something unseen about, behind the scene about what is happening.
No, Mr. Pathak, I don't think anybody will have, I'll come to you, Mr. Chaudhary. Anybody will have any objection to IB's functioning in the proper manner in which it needs to do in relation to national security and things like that. But I am again going to read one paragraph in this report, which again, I mean, is this the kind of reporting which is done and this kind of conclusions being jumped at? Another conspiracy, this is what the report states, another conspiracy, a vicious cycle is set up, funds are obtained from abroad, an NGO is set up, a few articles are commissioned, a PR firm is recruited, and slowly with the help of the media an image is created. And then awards are procured from foreign countries to enhance this image. Such a vicious cycle, a network of finance activity award is set up, and once they have secured an award, no one in Hindustan dares raise a finger, no matter how many failings of the award. I mean, this guy, are they writing an article or are they giving a report?
I can only say I hope this is an expression of coming out of something really at the root of what they have found. And if you read it
sir was picked up from a website. This paragraph which he has just read out and in the IB report was actually just copy pasted from a website which had written this article in 2005.
Now, I'll again come back to the same
point. During your days as the IB director, you wouldn't have allowed this kind of language to be used in a report?
Or copy-paste?
I'll only say...
Or copy-paste?
I'll only say that I would... my organization would take every responsibility for why something is being said. Even if this is being said in a little a literal way this thing. But this is not the issue. The issue is the government should know what it is based on. So it's that which really concerns the, will, should concern the government. And I'm sure that will happen. There are people who write in a particular way. We discourage too much of literary flavor in
literary flair, which seems to be the case in this case. But as Saikat was pointing out, it's been copy pasted. Suman, very quickly, does this report concern you? Do you think that this is an issue in which you people, all of you, should be really concerned, or you think that this is something which will pass away and you need not be so worried about it?
I don't know. It depends on what the IB has in mind, and I don't know what the government has in mind. But I think it is insulting to suggest that the technical expert committee has no brains, has no intelligence to come to their own conclusions, that the parliamentary standing committee has no brains, has no intelligence to come to their own conclusions, that they are all influenced by some mythical NGOs who are telling them to do it, and they all follow like sheep to the slaughter. That's a very insulting suggestion to make.
Okay.
Now let me take you back to
very
to
quickly.
20 years ago.
We're running out of time, Suman. Very quickly.
See, the government also changes its views. There was a time when the government was very much in favor of seed patents.
Right.
All of us who oppose seed patents as being against the national interest could have been called anti-national at that time, but it is the government that listened, that came around to the viewpoint and actually went against seed patents and drafted a law which is completely different.
Okay.
So how does the IB come into this? And if it is indulging in character assassination, let it put the facts also on the table.
Okay. Mr. Chaudhary, very quickly, is this something which is a cause for concern? What is the action which you people will take, or is it something that...
Yes, since you are running out of time, let me first point out the lacuna. Lacuna here is that all the laws and rules only talk of actions which are prohibited. They don't talk about the content part of it. And my concern is, if Ministry of Home Affairs or FCRA comes up with a list that holding views contrary to the views of Government of India on following issues is prohibited. First nuclear, then GM, then land acquisition. If that is given, even on the website of the ministry, and we don't follow it, then we are accused.
So now you don't...
As things stand today, we are expected to get the hint and stop talking about it. So it is very difficult.
Okay. Very quickly, Saikat.
Just one thing.
The motive behind this report, what do you think was the motive behind the report and whatever you
No, see, that I can't quickly. Really get into, but my point is this, that the IB is a fine organization and we must defend the organization. But my point is, a report like this coming out, and it has come out, only embarrasses and actually reflects poorly on the great work that the other officers have done and have done a lot of contribution. And you've seen a lot of successes by the IB's sterling work just recently.
Right.
Such a report does great harm to the organization.
It does great harm to the organization, but obviously this report, if it has been asked to be given, then we'll have to see why and what behind this, what is the... intention behind this report, but for that we will have to wait and watch. But the fact of the matter is, such a report exists and the government has not denied it. We'll have to see how it will all work out in the coming days. Thanks to all my guests, Mr. DC Pathak, Anil Chaudhary, Saikat Datta and Suman Sahai. Please keep watching. We'll come back with another issue in Big Picture same time on Monday. Meanwhile, have a great weekend.